these various characteristics of the physical elements, like the aroma of flower and colors resulting from the mixture of the dust in the air, the Lord appears to lower systems of worship according to one's desire, although he appears as a demigod and not in his original form. What is the use of these other forms? May the original Supreme Personality of Godhead please fulfill my desires. It is being said here, Lord takes on different forms in order to fulfill the desires of people who want to worship him from different lower forms of worship. And sometimes he appears as different devas. So, after saying that, and then the doctor said, well, what is the use of these forms? For the Supreme Personality of Godhead, to fulfill my desires. Srila Prabhupada's purport. The impersonalist imagined the various demigods to be forms of the Lord. For example, the Mayavadis worship five demigods, Panchopasanam. They do not actually believe in the form of the Lord, but for the sake of worship, they imagine some form to be God. This is interesting. They don't believe in the form, but they know that there's need for form in order for worship, so they imagine some form to be the Supreme, and therefore they worship that, and they say the form is just for the sake of worship, it has no reality. Generally, they imagine a form of Vishnu, a form of Shiva, and forms of Ganesh, the sun god, and Durga. This is called Panchopasanam. The Mayavadis are very astute in this Panchopasanam worship of five different devas. Daksha, however, wanted to worship not an imaginary form, but the supreme form of the Lord, Sri Krishna. In this regard, Sri Vishwanath Chakravarti describes the difference between the Supreme Personality of Godhead and an ordinary living being. As pointed out in the previous verse, Vampuram Veda Gunas Chitat Yav, the Veda Sarvam Gyanam Pandekide. The all powerful Supreme Lord knows everything, but a living being does not actually know the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So God knows everybody and everything. He knows something. As Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, I know everything, but no one knows me. This is the difference between the Supreme Lord and the ordinary living being. In a prayer in the Srimad Bhagavatam, Kinkuti says, my dear Lord, you exist inside and outside, yet no one can see you. So God is everywhere. He's inside, he's outside, he's within the atom, he's in the zone of birth. And no one can see him. Why? Premanjari Prabhupada Valochanena Satasa Daiva Vidyasi Vilopiyanti Yamshama Sunda Achinta Guna Sarupa Govindamani Purusham Kamaham Vajani. Only when you are fully in love with the Lord can you see the Lord. So that is the goal, is to develop that love for Krishna, because that is the perfection of our existence. The conditioned soul cannot understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead by speculative knowledge or by imagination. One must therefore know the Supreme Personality of Godhead by the grace of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He reveals himself, but he cannot be understood by speculation. As stated in Srimad Bhagavatam 10.14.29, Tathapi de deva padam vijangayam prasara esanu guhita evahi janadi tadvam bhagavan mahino tachanya eko kichiram chivim. My Lord, if one is favored even by a slight trace of the mercy of your lotus feet, you can understand the greatness of your personality. But those who speculate to understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead are unable to know you, even though they continue to study the Vedas for many years. So one cannot know God by speculation or by shastric study. One has to access that mercy. one has. Therefore, devotees are always trying to get the mercy. It's not so much what we do, it's the mood we do whatever we do. Sometimes we're attached to the activities, but we don't really understand that the activity is not the way to bring the mercy. It is the mood that the activities perform brings the mercy. Even if the activity is not perfect, if the mood is perfect, then the mercy is available. So Krishna is very inclined to give mercy when he is pleased. So trying to please him is the goal of devotional service. So people can study, have great, you know, philosophical abilities, can speak nicely, can do so many things in an expert way. But that doesn't attract the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The attraction is devotion. And so therefore, the devotee who is humble and begs for the mercy of the Lord, and gets the mercy of the Lord. Humility allows us to beg for the mercy of the Lord. If there's pride, it's hard to beg for that mercy. It's impossible to beg for that mercy. Because one thinks, I'm okay. Why should I beg for it? I don't know. But that is contrary to the living entity's position in the material world, because we're not all right. And so therefore, this idea of being all right, of being self, feeling self-confident, is a type of illusion that causes the living entity to develop this pride, and this pride causes them to make mistakes, and ultimately fall down. So one should always be in a mood of begging for the mercy of the Lord, and that is in the mood of praying to the Lord, begging for the Lord, begging for the association with the devotees. All these will be elements that attract the mercy of the Lord. Otherwise, if you think we're all right, you think you're okay, then pay over it. This is the verdict of the Shastras. The ordinary man may be a great philosopher, may speculate upon what the absolute truth is, what his form is and where he is existing. But he cannot understand these truths, save in the PVG by those who are made this for that Buddha. One can understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead only by devotional service. This is explained by the Supreme Personality himself. And by the Vigila Bhakti Man of the Jayamati, Yogami is tested with the Dhamma. One can only just understand the Supreme Personality of God as he is only by devotional service. Unintelligent persons want to imagine or concoct the form of the Lord of the Personality of Godhead. The devotees want to worship the actual Personality of Godhead. Therefore, Bhakti prays, one may think of you as personal, impersonal, and imaginary, but I wish to pray to your Lordship that you may fulfill my desires to see you as you actually are. This is a nice prayer. God may be personal, he may be impersonal, and people also imagine things. But what you actually are, reveal that to me. Because that is the truth. Our speculations, or even our studies, can never come to the conclusion of what is God. And when God reveals that, can one be assured that this is the absolute truth. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur comments that this verse is especially meant for the impersonalists who think that he himself is the supreme because there is no difference between the living entity and God. There is no difference between the living entity and God. Is that true? Okay. So what is the yes part? What is the no part? Yeah, so we have qualitatively the same nature as God, but quantitatively, he is complete whole, we are a fraction of that whole. So we are spirit, he is spirit, we are tiny spirit, or we are what we saw. Our spiritual existence has a tendency to be overcome by another energy called the material energy. For his spiritual existence is not affected by the material energy, he even controls that energy. We try to do the same thing, we try to control it. And we have some ability to control something. But we cannot be completely in control of material energy. So although we have some ability to control, generally when we try to control the material energy, because it's controlled by a higher energy, Krishna, that energy controls us. This is an interesting point. When you try to control the material energy, you get controlled by that energy. And everyone's trying to do that. Well, how do I live? How do I do things? Well, you depend on Krishna when you make your efforts. If he makes the results happen one way, that is fine. If he makes it happen another way, that is also fine. We are not so much attached to the results, we are attached to worshiping him. And whatever he provides in the execution of our worship for him, that is satisfactory for us. We don't have to worry. He really has no cares because he knows. If I simply depend on Krishna, and I depend on the mercy of my spiritual master, I'm good. There's no anxiety. Life becomes easy. The natural. Let's say easy is not the word. Natural. Everyone is living in an unnatural type of existence. What is that unnatural existence? That I'm the center. And therefore, I have to control in order to enjoy. If I can't control, I can't enjoy. It's because I'm just all about me. So that's material life. Spiritual life means how to use what Krishna has given us for the pleasure of Krishna in the universe of things. So he wants to know what God actually is. So Vishwanath Thakur comments that this verse is especially meant for the impersonalists who think that he himself is the supreme and there is no difference between the living being and God. The Mayavada philosopher thinks that there is only one supreme truth and that he is also that supreme truth. Actually, this is not knowledge but foolishness. And this verse is especially meant for such fools. His knowledge has been stolen by illusion. Mayapavitigyanam. Who knows that verse? Mayapavitigyanam. Where does that verse come? Which part of the Gita is that? Who knows the whole verse? Avajanti mam muha, manasam paramastitam, param bhavam ajnanatam, mamabhuta maheshvara. That's a different image. Maya aparita jnanam. Knowledge has been stolen by illusion. So Prabhupada uses that description in relationship to the Vodha verse I just quoted. Avajanti mam muha. No, that's the wrong verse. What is the one? Yeah, that's another one. But there's another verse. What is that verse? It's 7:15 in the Bhagavad Gita. Who knows 7:15? The phone knows. Just ask Al, he'll tell you. What is that again? This is Kritina Mudha, Papadhyante Naradama, Maya Apadita Jnanam, Suram Bhavama Astritam. That's the verse. So four kinds of persons never take to devotional life. Who are those four kinds of persons? They're described in this verse. So what is the four? And then what is the first one? First one. Sanskrit. Namam Bhistri Kena Mudha. So what is the word Mudha mean? Cool. So what does that refer to? What type of people are like that? Yeah, but these are all four of these are material. There's four people described in there. So what is the first one? Come on. Namam Bhistri Kena Mudha. What's a Mudha? So what type of person is being described in that? Hard-working beast. People who just spend all day in the factories just working hard for money. And they just, what do they do when they get the money? They just, they just get drunk and try to enjoy sex going for them. They're the lowest forms. The gross materialists. Those who simply find pleasure in, demoted ignorance, sleeping, or in watching various kinds of sport programs like that. So these are mudhas. So Maya and the Mahabhu speaking mudha, prapadyante naradamas, the holy naradamas. So how is that described in that verse? Who knows in the animal? They're called lowest of the mankind, but what is their actual characteristics? What kind of focus do they have in material life? What is their focus? The first one is just working hard like an ass. He doesn't care about anything, just his beer, actually. Well, these people, they think by social and political planning, society can become advanced. They're politicians, sociologists, people who want to make a better life by adjusting the political and social atmosphere of the country. So they're always coming up with new kinds of institutions to better people's lives. Better political plans, more political plans, different kinds of social welfare programs to help people. They simply think that just by making these structures, one can be happy and make success in their life. Okay, what's the next one? Maya Prithikana. Who are they? This is the one that's being here described for. Who are those persons? Mayavada. There's another type of person that's described. Scholars. Oh, okay, got it. Thank you. People who just study books all day, they have so many knowledge of so many things. Scientists, academics, scholars, okay. They know a little bit about everything and a lot about something. And this is them. So they have so much knowledge, but they don't know the real goal of knowledge is to know the Supreme Personality of Godhead or engage in devotional service. So, philosophers, college professors, like that. And the last one, a Surya Master, Bhav Masrutam. Atheists. People who have no belief in anything, they're always making propaganda that there is no God. We drink, we marry, and die. That's the whole problem. And as you enjoy life while you got it, there's only one life. Just enjoy. There's no God. God's simply an idea just to keep you distracted from the real goal of enjoying it. So there's a whole class of people like that. So these are the four. So Vishnu Chakravarti says that such persons, Jnani Maninam, think themselves very advanced, but actually they are unintelligent. It's like, if you go, you'll see an animal, such as a donkey, and he'll be going, filmmaker remaking all these, and having him, he thinks, oh, such beautiful poetry. It should be recorded and written down. Probably don't stay. And then he thinks, oh, yes, the symphony, is so beautiful. Maybe another donkey might think like that, but that's it. Everyone thinks about it, guy's just making a lot of noise. So people who have that intelligence, they think, oh, they're so intelligent, they know so many things. But one who knows they don't know anything. That's why when Prabhupada says they're all intelligence, too, because they all know the thing that is most important is that who they are, what is the goal of life, and how to achieve it, and what is the nature of the supreme. So basically, because they, even though they have so much knowledge, they know nothing. In fact, their knowledge just takes them in the wrong way. So, and then in Prabhupada goes on, in this regard, Srila Madhvacharya says, Svadehastam harim prahur adamam jiva evati madhyavam chapi anir nitam jivan binam janandamam. There are three classes of men, the lowest, adamam, those in the middle, madhyamam, and the best, uttamam. The lowest, adamam, think that there is no difference between God and the living entity, except that the living entity is under designations where the absolute truth has no designations. So if you try to become designationless, try to become one, the absolute one, the undifferentiated energy is the supreme. And therefore, variety is a symptom of material life in its own mind. That's what they think. And the variety is a symptom of material life, differentiation. Everybody is one, the Supreme is one, we are all one with the Supreme, we are all the Supreme. That is the philosophy. So one devotee was at a Kumbh Mela, and there were many types of spiritualists there, so when there was one Mayavada, and this devotee was staying with the Mayavada in the same tent. And we know if you've been to Kumbh Mela, it is cold. It can be really cold. So this Mayavada had a nice blanket, and he was keeping warm. And this devotee then only had a little shawl. So they were discussing philosophy, and the Mayavada was saying, oh, it's all one. So the devotee said, okay, if everything is one, whether you have the blanket or I have the blanket, it doesn't matter because it's all one. So give me your blanket. So the Mayavada, he might have stick to his philosophy, so he gave me the blanket. And so he was freezing all night. So when you actually challenge them on their philosophy, one time one of our senior devotees was out on sankirtan, and one boy was saying, it's all one, it's all one, it's all one. And so the one said, all right, give me all your money, because it doesn't matter whether you have it or I have it, because it's all one. So he wanted to prove his point. So he gave all his money, which is a couple hundred dollars. And then the devotee left. And then the boy came to the temple a night later and said, I need some money for bus fare. Can you give me some? So sometimes they're so rock hard and they want to prove their point. But when it comes to practical understanding, it has no value. So what is the oneness? The oneness is that of the quality of the living beings in God. The difference is that the living entity can never be God. The living entity is always a particle of the absolute truth who is meant to connect to the absolute truth through the principle of service. There's no other way to connect. One can get a little bit of connection through working for Supreme. One can get a little bit of understanding of God by studying studying the scripture, one cannot really connect with the Lord unless one engages in devotional service. Devotional service is, as Maharaj says in the Srimad Bhagavatam in the same canto, devotional service is the highest element within the human society. And the highest activity within devotional service is the chanting of the names of the Lord. So there's nothing more greater than devotional service, and there's nothing more greater within devotional service than to glorify the Lord, which is the purpose of devotional service, than to chant His holy name. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram Ram. The devotees don't want to be God. Even if they had a chance to be God, they wouldn't be God. Because the devotee knows that one can enjoy unlimitedly as the servant of God. Sometimes it says that the servant of God can enjoy just on the same level as the Lord. As a servant of a great man, he lives in the house of the great man, has all the, what we say, facilities that the great man has in his own possession. The servant uses everything for himself also, by the grace of the great man, of course. So devotees don't even want to be God, even if they could be. Why? Because to be servant of God is so nice. You get to serve the absolute truth. And that is the perfection of our existence. Service is actually such a high element of activity that even God wants to be servant. So he comes as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu just to take the role of his devotee, just to experience the happiness of being the servant of the Lord, although he's the one. So you can see how exalted it is to be a servant. Because sometimes that word is used in a derogatory or demeaning way. But actually, to be a servant is the greatest thing that one can do when that service is for the Supreme, or for the pure devotee of the Lord. So that's the highest thing that even God wants to become a servant. He comes, and he also goes to school. He has a spiritual master, Candramauli, who learns lessons. He takes the role of an ordinary person just not only to teach, but also to experience that position of being in a subordinate position with him, that lifetime. It's amazing when you think about it. So one should never think, oh, to be a servant. Prabhupada says the more you become a servant, the more you are exalted by the Lord. So, therefore, the Lord is always thinking, how can I serve? How can I serve? Because that way one is always in the best possible position to gain the mercy of the Lord. In their opinion, referring to those who think of in the Mayavadas, in their opinion, as soon as the designations of the material body of desire, the jiva, the living entity, will mix with the supreme. So as soon as our body is gone, the Mayavadas think, then we merge with the supreme, we become one with the supreme. To give the argument of the tat-kasa-tat-kasa, in which the body is compared to a pot within the sky, and the sky, the body is compared to a pot with the sky within and the sky without. So there's a pot, and there is sky inside the pot, and there's sky outside the pot. When the pot breaks, the sky inside becomes one with the sky outside. And so the impersonalists say that the living entity becomes one with the supreme. This is their argument. And Srila Madhvacharya says that such an argument is put forward by the lowest class of men. Another class of men cannot. Why? Because we're not the pot that breaks. That's a bad analogy. Another class of men cannot ascertain what the actual form of the Supreme is, but they agree that there is a Supreme who controls the activities of the living beings. Such philosophers are accepted as mediocre, that means in the middle. The best, however, are those who understand the Supreme Sachit and Individuha. Puranadadi Gunakam Sarvajivan Vilakshanam. This form is completely spiritual, full of bliss, and completely distinct from that of the conditioned soul or any other living being. Uttamastu Harim Pahus Tarata Mayena Purishucha. Such philosophers are the best because they know that the Supreme Personality of Godhead reveals himself differently to worshippers in different modes of the pure nature. People say it doesn't matter how you worship, just worship. But here it says that according to the type of worship, the Lord reveals himself in the nature of the worship. They, referring to the Mayavadis, know that there are 33 million demigods just to convince the conditioned soul that there is a supreme power and to induce him to agree to worship one of these demigods so that by the association of the devotees he may be able to understand that Krishna is the Supreme Personality. So here's a way to elevate one's consciousness for those who are lower. They worship the demigods, but their worship culminates in the association of devotees who understand the Supreme Lord. As Lord Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Mata Parapayanyanya, Kishin Askita Nanjaya, there is no true superior than me. Ahamahi Devanam, I am the original of the demigods. Aham Savasya Prabhu, I am superior to everyone, even Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva and the other demigods. These are the conclusions of the Shastras, and one who accepts these conclusions should be considered a first-class philosopher. Such a philosopher knows that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the Lord of the demigods. Deva Devam Svaram Sukham Anandam Jnana Vidyam. And the purport. So, look at about so we get a little understanding of what is not. And sometimes we find there's a lot of that in the Shastras. What is not the absolute truth? What is not the perfect understanding? And therefore, until we know that clear, it's hard to understand what is. Because the nature of the absolute truth and the nature of spiritual psychology and philosophy is very intricate. And therefore, the Mayavadis and the impersonalists are very expert at putting forth theories and arguments based on the Vedas to convince people of their understanding. So, therefore, we have to hear from Srila Prabhupada regularly to understand what is the, what is not. A lot of times, one of the anarchists that the devotees have to overcome is to understand what is contrary to bhakti. Sometimes we see devotees know what is devotional service, but they have a hard time understanding what is not. And by mixing in certain things that are either philosophical or against the practice, in other words, wrong types of practices, we water down and minimize the effects of our devotional activities. So therefore, when Prabhupada first started the Krishna movement, he said, one should know knowledge and nescience side by side. Nescience means ignorance. To know what is not. Because there are a lot of people who can speak very nicely. And they can convince you, unless you are fixed in the process of devotional service, that devotional service is something different than what you're thinking of. Sometimes they use that argument, but actually, what you say is right, but there's much more. And therefore, they come up with other ideas and theories that you and you need to know in order to practice your devotional service properly. So we find there's add-ons, there's speculations on what has been given, there's various types of misconceptions, and there's also just minimizing what is important and maximizing what is not important. Just like it says, to chant Hare Krishna is very important. Where you chant it, that is less important. Of course, it can be a factor also, but in other words, there's always an injunction and a sub-injunction. So sometimes they emphasize the sub-injunction rather than... The injunction is everyone must accept a bona fide spiritual master, and the sub-injunction is who you accept. So you may accept this one, you may accept that one. But the point is, everyone must accept a bona fide spiritual master. That's the injunction. Who you accept, that's the sub-injunction. So they might propagate the sub-injunction that you have to accept this person as the actual principle. And it goes on in the name of So these are more subtle aspects of how the philosophy can get twisted, the practice can get, what we say, abrogated in the long run. Okay, any questions or comments? Yes.
When Shakra Pat in the commentary, he was talking about this four types of people who don't surrender to Krishna. And I was thinking, why did Shakra Pat do this in the commentary? Maybe because we are sometimes like that too. It's like sometimes we like Buddha's working hard, but we're not doing this in right consciousness, and sometimes we like atheists, and I don't really do it out of devotion to Krishna.
We have certain elements that are still material when the activity of devotional service is not material. So we still bring in some young conceptions, misconceptions. Working hard for Krishna is devotional service. Working hard for yourself is what is described in Bhagavad Gita, useless labor. So the idea is keep everything focused on Krishna. You can't be an atheist for Krishna, that's for sure. That doesn't work. So unless we believe that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, we may have certain atheistic tendencies. That's mentioned also in other places. Unless you believe that Krishna is the supreme absolute personality of God, in other words, person, that's the most important part of that statement, and he is the person. So, unless that is fully there, we still have these atheistic tendencies. You know, I've seen devotees, I know devotees who practicing for so many years, and then after some time they come in contact with other spiritualists and they start changing their understanding of doctrine. Well, you don't really need a guru, because there should be nobody between you and God. But it's not understood that way. They say the idea is the guru is the medium by which you can approach the world and also understand the world. So he is not in between. He is like you have eyes, but the eyes cannot see perfectly. So the glass is just able to see. the glasses don't see, but they need to see. So the spiritual master is our aid to approaching and seeing Krishna. So sometimes we say, you know, so he's not really in between, he's just making it more, what we say, he's making it happen because he can't approach it, he can't really approach the actual truth. Any other questions? Does that answer your question? Yes. My question is, so this is like, the Guru is nothing in between. If you just like place our hands and put the same Krishna's hands, and then we have a relationship with Krishna.
Yeah, you can find Krishna's hands.
Krishna can only be approached by a pure devotee. But the spiritual master, because he's a pure devotee, can take your mixed devotion and offer it to Krishna. And then you have, and then you can approach the Supreme through his mercy. Any other questions? Okay, thank you. So we'll go back to my brother, Tom and PJ.
Thank you.